The new AlphaFold 3 algorithm is so much more powerful than AlphaFold 2, which merely solved protein folding. That's because it doesn't just deal with how single proteins are going to fold. Instead, it can even look at combinations or complexes of different proteins together, and also DNA and RNA and ligands. Now, the ligands are really interesting because they're potential drug candidates. They're small molecules that may or may not bind to certain proteins in particular ways that could, for example, fix a misbehaving protein. So that's why a lot of people are very excited about AlphaFold 3. But what's really surprising is that despite being a much more powerful model than AlphaFold 2, it's also a lot simpler. There's a couple of reasons for this. The first is because to accommodate all of these different modalities, so the proteins as well as the DNA, RNA, and ligands, you need to really simplify the structure of the previous model. The previous algorithm, for example, had a whole structure component, which was all about trying to figure out how the various triangles that basically form the backbone of any protein will be relative to each other, what angles they'll be and what distances apart they'll be. But when you're trying to generalize beyond proteins, you no longer can talk about these triangles. So instead of worrying about triangles and angles and rotations and all of those things, we're just going to deal with the positions of every atom. And the way that they did it makes a lot of sense in hindsight. They used diffusion. So diffusion is the magic behind AI art algorithms like Midjourney. In the training process, all you have to do is take the known positions of various atoms and then just add some noise to it and get the algorithm to try and figure out where those atoms should be. Well, this is obviously very powerful because the same kind of method could help you figure out the structure of any kind of molecule. But not only that, it's also a lot simpler because instead of dealing with all these special cases for every type of molecule, you have one generalized framework that works equally well for all of them. There's also really good reason to believe that algorithms that are multimodal, in other words, they can deal with different modes of data, like for example, pictures and text, are more powerful than individual models. So an example from OpenAI's research is when they trained a particular model to understand text and images in the same sort of way. And they found that this model was better at purely text-based tasks than just a text-based model. And that makes sense because by forcing the model to also understand images, it learns new things about how the world works, and it can transfer that knowledge to text tasks as well. A similar thing is probably happening for AlphaFold 3 here, where things that it learns about proteins can be applicable to other molecules as well. And so to make this work, you need to have a model that treats all these different types of molecules on equal footing. In other words, it embeds them all into the same space. And the fact that AlphaFold 3 is more general in this way is probably the reason why AlphaFold 3 beats AlphaFold 2 even on just the pure protein folding task. There's one other major simplification to the AlphaFold 3 algorithm that I want to talk about because I thought it was really surprising and I didn't really expect that something like this would work. They majorly de-emphasize the role of the MSA. As I explained in my last video about AlphaFold 2, there are two different objects that contain the information about the protein that goes through the model and gets updated. So usually you would put all the information in just one object, but in AlphaFold 2, there's this strange tension where there are two different objects that both encode different parts of the information about that protein. And in the end, they both contribute to figuring out what the structure is going to be. So those two things are the MSA and the pair representation. So the MSA captures the evolutionary data about this protein. So suppose that you're interested in a particular protein in a particular species, and you want to understand how this protein folds. But if you search up that protein in various databases, you'll find many other proteins for other species with very similar proteins that are basically fulfilling the same function inside of those animals. Now, what that tells us is that there are some parts of this protein that are important to its function and some parts that matter a little bit less. So, for example, if you find that this region is always conserved, all of the different proteins have the exact same thing for that part, then that's probably an important part. Whereas if some other parts are just sort of randomly mutating here and there, that probably suggests that it doesn't really matter if they mutate. It doesn't affect the function of the protein. So this MSA gives us information about the evolutionary history of this protein. But there's also another representation that's important, which is called the pair representation. It takes that single protein that we care about and then looks at pairs and sees how they interact with each other. So in other words, it's a matrix where each entry represents a pair and maybe encodes some information about them. So for example, how far apart are they? Or what angle are they relative to each other? That sort of thing. So both of these representations are important and they get updated throughout the algorithm in AlphaFold 2. But it's definitely clear that one of them is more important than the other. Like in the second part of AlphaFold 2, in the structure module, you can see that the pair representation is barely consulted at all, whereas the MSA is quite important and gets used again and again. It's really strange that in AlphaFold 3, the tables have turned. The MSA is now much less important, and instead they try and get the information from the MSA to be pushed into the pair representation, and then it's basically the pair representation that encodes the majority of the information and gets used later. So you can see this in this module called the MSA module. So this module's task is it's the only one that gets to see the full MSA, and it's supposed to try and squeeze that information into the pair representation. But you can see in this module itself that you barely do anything to the MSA, whereas you do all of these attention-like mechanisms for the pair representation. In fact, there's only one sort of attention-like thing that happens to the MSA at all in this entire algorithm, and it's this. This is basically replacing the row attention, which was looking inside of the MSA and looking at different pairs of amino acids and seeing how they're related to each other. The way that they've done it is really clever. They use the pair representation to decide the attention scores. So that was very, very clever. But what I was confused about was what happened to the column attention for the MSA? So the column attention used to be what dealt with the evolutionary data, because it would look at a particular spot in a protein and then compare it to what it looked like in different proteins. But now there isn't an attention mechanism that does this. Instead, there's this kind of like averaging down the columns that then gets put into the pair representation. It never gets directly updated in the MSA itself. So you can see that they've basically tried to make a bottleneck where all the information, if it's useful, has to end up in the pair representation. I think it's interesting that you still need the MSA at all, especially because certain types of molecules don't have a MSA, like ligands. They're just molecules, like there's no evolutionary history for them. Maybe that's why the MSA is kind of de-emphasized. Maybe it's better not to, you know, use the evolutionary data as a crutch, and it's better for the model to just straight up learn the chemistry and the physics that makes these molecules interact with each other. My guess about the future of these models is that they're just going to become more general. Firstly, they're going to take more types of inputs, but also I think they're going to have more types of outputs. Instead of just looking at the structure, which is quite a constrained problem, I think it's going to be more like LLMs, where they're a little bit more open-ended at predicting all kinds of things about various molecules. At least, that's what I'd like to see. If you want to see my video about the AlphaFold 2 algorithm, then you can find it here.